You are listening to The Life of Jesus Christ in a Year from the Visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I will be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of The Life of Jesus Christ and Biblical Revelations available from TAN. Before we get to today's reading, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Jesus Christ on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you were blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings. We graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ our Lord and Savior. We ask this in the name of the most holy Lamb of God and through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day 11, and in this episode, we will continue reading from volume 1, chapter 10. We will focus on Melchizedek. I have often seen Melchizedek, but never as a human being. I have always seen him as a being of another nature, as an angel, as one sent by God. I have never at any time seen any determinate dwelling place, any home, any family, any associates connected with him. I never saw him eating, drinking, or sleeping, and never did the thought occur to me that he was a mortal. He was clothed as no priest at the time on the earth, but like the angels in the heavenly Jerusalem. His robes were such as Moses upon the command of God, afterward ordained the priestly vestments should be. I have seen Melchizedek appearing here and there, interposing and legislating the affairs of nations. As, for instance, at the celebration of victories after war, at that time waged with such cruelty. Wherever he appeared, wherever he was, he exercised an irresistible influence by his mere presence. No one opposed him, and yet he never resorted to harsh measures. Even the idolaters cheerfully accepted his decisions and acted upon his advice. He had no companion of his own nature. He was entirely alone. Sometimes he had two hired couriers. They were clothed in short white garments, and they ran on before him to announce his coming. He dismissed them when their mission was over. All that he needed, he had without trouble of acquiring. They, from whom he received anything, could always spare what they gave. They bestowed it upon him with joy. They regarded him with reverential fear, but esteemed themselves happy to be in his company. Although the wicked found fault with him, yet they humbled themselves in his presence. Melchizedek, that being of a higher order, was regarded by the great ones of the pagan world. Those sensuous, godless men, in much the same light that an extraordinarily holy man would be looked upon at the present day, if he suddenly appeared amongst us as a stranger doing good to all around. Thus I saw Melchizedek at the court of Semiramis in Babylon, where she reigned with indescribable grandeur and magnificence. She caused immense buildings to be erected by her slaves, whom she oppressed far more severely than did Pharaoh, the children of Jacob in Egypt. The most horrible idolatry was practiced among the Babylonians. Human victims were buried up to the neck in the earth and thus offered in sacrifice. It is hardly credible to what a degree all kinds of luxury, magnificence, opulence, and the arts were carried. Semiramis also waged great wars. Her armies were composed of countless warriors, but these wars were almost always against nations, off toward the east. She went not much westward. The nations toward the north were dark and sinister-looking people. As time went on, there arose in the kingdom of Semiramis a numerous people of the Semitic race. After the building of the tower, their ancestors had remained in Babylon. They lived as a little pastoral tribe under tents, raised cattle, and celebrated their religious ceremonies by night, either in an open tent or under the starry sky. Many blessings attended them. They were prosperous in all things, and their cattle was always remarkably fine. Semiramis, the diabolical woman, resolved to exterminate this tribe, and she had already destroyed a great many belonging to it. She knew from the blessing attending them that God had merciful designs over them. Therefore, would she, as an instrument of the devil, oppress them. When the distress of these people was at its height, Melchizedek appeared. He went to Semiramis, demanded permission for them to depart, and rebuked her for her cruelty. Semiramis yielded to his desires, and he led them in different bands toward Palestine. Melchizedek dwelt in a tent near Babylon, and here he broke that bread to the good people, from which they received strength to depart. He pointed out to them here and there in Canaan places suitable for settlements, and they received from him lands of various quality. He divided them off according to their purity, in order that they should not mix with others. Their name sounded like Samanan or Semanan. Melchizedek pointed out to some of them as suitable for a settlement the region which was afterward the site of the Dead Sea. But their city was destroyed with Sodom and Gomorrah. Semiramis received Melchizedek with great reverence. She secretly dreaded him on account of his wisdom. He appeared before her as the king of the morning star, that is, of the most distant eastern land. She fancied that he might perhaps woo her for his bride. But he spoke to her sternly, reproached her with cruelty, and foretold to her the destruction of her pyramid at Memphis. Semiramis grew speechless from terror, and I saw the punishment that fell upon her. She became like a beast. She was for a long time penned up, and they cast to her in derision grass and straw in a manger. Only one servant was faithful to her and furnished her with food. She was freed from the chastisement, but she carried on her disorders anew. She came at last to a frightful end, her intestines being torn from her body. She was aged 117 years. Melchizedek came to be regarded as a prophet, as a teacher, as a being from a higher sphere, with whom all things succeeded. There were at that time, as also later, many such apparitions of beings of a higher order. They were to the people of that age as familiar as were the angels in Abraham's time. But diabolical apparitions also were frequent, in the same way as false prophets rose up by the side of the true. The departure of the Semitic race from Babylon bears some analogy to that of the Israelites from Egypt, although the former were by no means so numerous as the latter. Of the Semanenses, whom Melchizedek settled in Palestine, I saw long before the coming of Abraham three men on the so-called Bread Mountain in the neighborhood of Thabor. They lived in caves. They were of a browner complexion than Abraham and were clothed in skins. They bound a great leaf on their head to protect them from the sun. Their life, modeled on that of Henoch, was a holy one. Their religion was simple, though full of mysterious signification, and they had visions and revelations which they easily interpreted. Their religion taught that God would unite himself with man, and for that union they must prepare in every possible way. They also offered sacrifice. A third part of their daily allowance was they exposed to the sun, either to be consumed by it, or perhaps for the benefit of other needy creatures, that the latter was the case. I also saw these people live quite solitary, apart from the rest of the inhabitants of the country. The latter were not yet numerous and lived scattered here and there in abodes built in the style of fortified tent cities. I saw those three men going through the country, digging wells, cutting down forests, and laying the foundations of subsequent cities. I saw them driving the evil spirits from the air around whole regions and banishing them to other places, to poor, swampy, foggy districts. I saw again that the wicked spirits prefer such wretched abodes. I often saw these men wrestling with them. At first I wondered how cities could arise where they laid stones, which so soon became overgrown, and then I had another vision, in which I was shown a number of places, built on these sites, for instance, Safot, Bethsaida, Nazareth, where those three men worked on the spot upon which afterwards stood the house in which the angel delivered the message to Mary. Gethsepher, Sepphoris, in the region near Nazareth, where Anne's house afterwards stood. Megiddo, Nain, Aenon, the caves of Bethlehem and Hebron. I also saw them founding Mehemet and many other places that I have now forgotten. I saw them every month assembling on this mountain where Melchizedek broke a large cornered loaf, 3 feet square perhaps, and tolerably thick, into numerous little pieces, which he divided among them. The loaf was of a brownish color and had been baked in the ashes. I saw that Melchizedek always went to them without a companion. Sometimes he bore the loaf quite lightly, as if it merely floated above his hand, and again he drew near to the mountain. I saw it as a weight upon his shoulders. I think he took this precaution on approaching them, that they might look upon him as merely a man. Still they met him with great reverence, prostrating before him. He taught them how to plant vines on Thabor. He also gave them all kinds of seeds, which they scattered in many parts of the country, and which now grow wild there. I saw these people every day cutting a piece off the loaf, which with the brown spades they used at work. They also ate birds, which flew toward them in great numbers. They had festival days, and they were familiar with the stars. They celebrated the eighth day with prayer and sacrifice, also some days in the course of the year. I saw them also making numerous roads through the still wild country to the places where they had laid foundations, dug wells, and sowed seed. This they did that the people coming after them might, by following these roads, make settlements near the wells and fertile places prepared for them. I saw these three men often surrounded while at work by crowds of evil spirits, whom they could see. I saw these spirits by prayer and the word of command banished to swampy wastes. They departed instantly, and the men went quietly on with their work, clearing and purifying. They made roads to Cana, Megiddo, and Nain, and in this way they prepared the birthplace of most of the prophets. They laid the foundations of Abimahula and Dothan, and dug out the beautiful baths at Bethulia. Melchizedek still scoured the country alone, and as a stranger, no one knew where he lived. The three Samanesses were old, but still very active. On the site of the Dead Sea and in Judea, cities already existed. There were also further north, but none as yet in the central regions. The Samanenses dug their own graves and sometimes stretched themselves in them. One made his near Hebron, another on Thabor, and the third in the caves not far from Sephet. They were, in a certain sense, for Abraham, what John was for Jesus. They purified the country. They prepared the land and the ways. They sowed good fruit, and they brought water for the leader of God's people. But John prepared the heart for penance and for a second birth in Jesus Christ. The Samanenses did for Israel what John did also for the church. I have seen such men in other places also, where they had been introduced by Melchizedek. I often saw Melchizedek as he appeared in Palestine long before the time of Semiramis and Abraham, when the country was still a wilderness. He seemed to be laying it out, marking off and preparing certain districts. I saw him entirely alone, and I thought, what is this man doing here so early? There is not a human being in this place. I saw him near a mountain, boring a well. It was the source of the Jordan. He had a long, fine instrument, which, like a ray of light, pierced the mountainside. I saw him in the same way, opening fountains in different parts of the earth. In those early times, that is, before the deluge, I never saw the rivers gushing forth and flowing as they do now, but I saw volumes of water pouring down from a high mountain in the east. Melchizedek took possession of many parts of Palestine by marking them off. He measured off the site of the Pool of Bethsaida, and long before Jerusalem existed, he laid a stone where the temple was to stand. I saw him planting in the bed of the Jordan the 12 precious stones, upon which the priest stood with the Ark of the Covenant at the departure of the children of Israel. He planted them like seeds, and they increased in size. I always saw Melchizedek alone, save when he had to busy himself with the uniting, the separating, or the guiding of nations and families. I saw that Melchizedek built a castle at Salem, but it was rather a tent with galleries and steps around it, like the castle of Mensur in Arabia. The foundation alone was solid, for it was of stone. I think the four corners where the principal posts stood were still to be seen even in John's time. It had only a very strong foundation of stone, which looked like a fortification overrun with verdure. John had there his little hut of rushes. That tent castle was a resort for strangers and travelers, a kind of safe and convenient inn near the pleasant waters. Perhaps Melchizedek, whom I have always seen as the guide and counselor of the still unsettled races and nations, kept this castle as a place in which to harbor and instruct them. But even at that time, it bore some reference to baptism. This was Melchizedek's central point. From it, he started on his journeys to lay out Jerusalem, to visit Abraham, and to go elsewhere. Here also he gathered together and distributed families and peoples who settled in various places. All this took place previously to the offering of bread and wine, which I think was made in a valley south of Jerusalem. Melchizedek built Salem before he built Jerusalem. Wherever he labored and constructed, he seemed to be laying the foundation of a future grace, to be drawing attention to that particular place, to be beginning something that would be perfected in the future. Melchizedek belongs to the choir of angels that are set over countries and nations that brought messages to Abraham and the other patriarchs. They stand opposite the archangels Michael, Gabriel, and Raphael. This concludes our reading today about Melchizedek, and now we'll begin our reflection on what we just heard. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. It's often sung at priestly ordinations, and we kind of get a sense of that priestly role today of Melchizedek in our reading from Anne Catherine Emmerich. I appreciate what she shared, what she saw, all these things that pertain to Melchizedek. You know, we heard about the loaf of bread and it being broken and shared, you know, so that's a foreshadowing of the Holy Eucharist. We heard at the very end too, that there was a reference to Melchizedek and baptism. But even at that time, it bore some reference to baptism, she said. So in Melchizedek, we are kind of getting an anticipation of the priesthood of Jesus, the priesthood that would follow. It's interesting, his relationship to Semiramis, who we heard yesterday all about. And it's interesting, too, how she described Melchizedek. I have often seen Melchizedek, but never as a human being. I have always seen him as being of another nature, as an angel, as one sent by God. I have never at any time seen any determinate dwelling place, any home, any family, any associates connected with him. I think we could say just because Anne Catherine Emmerich didn't see these things doesn't mean they didn't happen or that they weren't there. She is saying she didn't see them. Now, there is something when it comes to Melchizedek. It says in the scriptures that he had no mother, no father, or something along those lines. And I had a parishioner ask me about that one day. And to be honest, even though I read something about it, I still didn't grasp it fully. But Melchizedek is really this figure who is just steeped in mystery, kind of the unknown about him. But again, we see his influence over people, how he brings the godly presence. He was compared a little bit to John the Baptist and Jesus, that Melchizedek was like what John the Baptist was for Jesus. So Melchizedek then kind of paving the way for others in the Old Testament as it unfolds. One of the last things I'll just mention is that, you know, we heard about Babylon and the Babylonians and the horrible idolatry that was practiced among them. Just always a good reminder not to have idols in our life, not to practice false worship of gods, but that we seek the true God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Jesus Christ. Tomorrow, when you tune in, we'll begin reading about Job. Job, an interesting figure of the Old Testament as well, popularly cited by so many. I can't wait for that reading tomorrow. This brings us to an end of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com. And use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ and biblical revelation with the help of Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you and Mary pray for you.